are live on good old Facebook.
Woo!
Hello, everybody.
Hi, team.
Welcome to this Sunday's edition of the Jeff and Katie Show. I didn't get it wrong this time.
No, you said it in the right order.
I said it in the right order, so to speak.
Well, who will be playing Jeff and who will be playing Katie today?
Well, I'm supposed to be on mic.
Yeah.
You can see. This is the thing we have to talk about.
Yeah.
So here's me already wanting to make adjustments. We're outside now. This past week, some of you weighed in while I did a couple of live tests. We moved from indoors to outdoors because we wanted to make sure that anybody who visited our show felt completely safe. And I think that's an important thing. So that's why we're trying this outdoors. You can hear the birds behind us, which is kind of wonderful.
Yes.
That's not fake.
No, we didn't pipe that in. No.
And we're trying a new sound system today, and Dave Alley, our tech director, was over here setting up these multiple tents and some lights that are on us from the front and a new mixing board, which is why we're on mic. I mean, it's, you know.
We are really high tech.
And clothespins. We have clothespins to hold all of our music in place on these stands because it was all blowing all over the place. So Dave Alley went on a little scavenger hunt and got us some clothespins to hold all of our music in place.
But we're not supposed to tell Neen Rock.
She doesn't follow our show, does she?
I don't think so.
So, Katie Doll, what are we going to do today?
Well, I thought lounge, you know, ask them to entertain us.
Mainly. It's hot out here, baby.
That's right. It sure is.
Entertain us. It actually feels pretty good.
Yeah. Well, we were going to, it does feel good, actually. These tents are very nice.
Yeah.
You know, I think we're gonna banter. We're going to talk about some things.
Is that what we're doing now?
Mm-hmm.
Does it qualify?
I think that is, yeah. This okay. is very meta banter. Banter about the banter.
Excellent.
And, mm-hmm, then we're going to have our other bee bake.
Oh, yeah, the bake.
Not then, but, you know, also.
Also.
And then we're going to have, we're also going to have trivia. And we may or may not have a special guest. And this special guest may or may not have names that, a first and a last name that both are pronounced as verbs, so you just see if you can.
Oh,
think
that's
of
interesting.
Which one? It, who
I have
the
not
special
heard
guest
this assessment
be.
Of our
yes.
special guests' names uh-huh. before. That's good.
Yeah,
that's good. I love
you
that.
You weigh in.
The other thing that we like to do is catch you up on any of the things that we've been still holding out with Raise the Curtain. We have one final event for that, which is kind of amazing, and that's going to be on July 17th, which is a Friday evening at 7:00. We're going to do a live Zoom. It's called Mary's Playlist, Mary being Mary Seberg, who was our board chair for 23 years, which is an incredible service. And what Mary has done is she's picked out a bunch of her favorite songs over the years, and we're going to perform those and talk about them with Mary on the night of the show, which is, again, the 17th. You can go to
rtc2020.givesmart.com.
And that will get you signed up for Mary's Playlist on the 17th. We did have another event that was a Buy It Now event. Doug Clemens had been doing his Zumba uh-huh. on Saturday mornings. He's apparently going to...
Zumba.
Uh-huh,
right?
He's going to... Yeah, exactly. He's going to continue those classes on Saturday mornings.
Oh.
You can see a promo of what Doug is proposing to do, which is delightful and wonderful in and of itself, because he's... hugely entertaining, that boy.
He sure is.
Yeah. And he and Nadja have put together a nice little promo telling you that you can sign up for his Zumba class on Saturday mornings. And I think it's only $2.
Oh, wow.
Right?
That is not very many bucks, everyone.
That is not very many bucks. So you can do that.
Hey, speaking of bucks.
Yeah.
If you had you may see a link to our buck in the bucket, paypal.me/abuckinthebucket. And that is a way to put a couple bucks in the bucket. If you were here, we would have a bucket that would make it more convenient and visually appealing. But as you are not here, we have, I mean, the throngs of you that are here, you can put them in the bucket.
The throngs.
But those, you know, the rest of you, there's a link, paypal.me/abuckinthebucket. And that helps us continue with our development work as we continue this season of this virtual season that we're
We're still doing all of our development work. We're going to do a reading of Love Stings coming up, and we're going to do a workshop of Sunflowered. So we have stuff in the works for sure. And the longer that this non-ability to perform live goes on, the more critical it becomes for us to make sure that we've got money in the Fred Alley New Music Fund. So
yeah,
there's that.
Yeah.
And now, I think, without any further ado, we should introduce our special guest. And that would be two verbs, one being chase and the other being stagger.
Chase Stoeger.
Woo! Hey, Chase.
Am I in?
You're here.
He chased awesome. Himself in and he staggered as he fell onto the chair.
He'll stagger out.
How are you, Chase?
Great. I'm doing great.
Are you?
I'm doing great. This is wonderful. It's beautiful out here today.
Yeah. Oh,
it is.
I brought the breeze.
We're using our patio, which is really kind of nice.
I don't know if you can hear those planes.
We're watching. And the crop duster.
Yeah, and the birds. Oh. I noticed the birds.
It's just like
too.
Being live in the park.
Yeah.
Right?
Planes,
planes flying
everything.
Over.
Yes.
I know.
Yeah.
So I think what we'd like to do before we chat too much is let's go ahead and do a song.
Okay.
We got a few songs to do for you today. And this first one will feature
check those
Chase.
Comments, Katie.
Stagger.
Oh, yeah. Look at that.
Chase,
there
of course, has appeared multiple times now, starting in 2008, maybe?
8 or 7?
I don't know if we did this show in 2007. Did we? Lumberjacks in Love?
No, because I didn't do Lumberjacks. I did the year after.
That's correct. So 2008 would have been your first time doing Lumberjacks in Love. And ever since then, Chase has been playing Moonlight in our productions of that show. And he's going to sing I Think I'm in Love with the Kid. I have to move some clothespins in order to...
This is the part where it's very high tech. This is the part where we...
put that behind...
Yes.
Get myself set up here.
Jeff also has, I'm here to report, some, he has, I see 3 paper clips and 4 clothespins.
It's
That's
ridiculous.
7 things.
You got gaff
Jeff
tape.
Jeff likes, I have 4 pieces of gaff tape.
Yep.
I'm going to do
1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 paper clips and a guitar capo.
You never know.
Yeah.
Never know when you need things like that.
Yeah.
Good luck, everybody.
Okay.
Thank you.
I'm going to move this mic out of the way. Chase?
I'm ready. Something is not right with me. I've been in the woods too long. For what I think seems turned about all wrong. Could it be cabin fever or something that bad herring did? I don't know how I've come to this. I think I'm in love with the kid. In the bunkhouse every night with me, never a doubt before. My heart has sent a message that my head cannot ignore. Could it be cabin fever or biscuits that were overdid? I don't know how I've come to this. I think I'm in love with the kid. I was a manly little boy. I smoked when I was 10. I beat up all the sissies. I was burly way back then. I burned my sister's cornhusk dolls. I looked bad in a dress. I fought and drank and swore a lot, but now I must confess that something is not right with me. I've been in the woods too long. For who am I to kid myself? This bonding is a bit too strong. Could it be cabin fever or something that I've always hid? I don't know how I've come to this. I think I'm in love with the kid. I don't know how I've come to this.
We even got the little button there, Katie doll.
What?
We even got the button.
We did get the button.
We got the button. The off button. Thanks, Chase. So, Chase, remind me again. We were just talking about your first appearance on the Northern Sky stage was when?
That would have been the year prior to that Lumberjacks, 2007.
2007.
Doing Cabin with a View.
Cabin with a View.
As Chip.
Chip.
Chip. I can't remember Chip's last name.
Chip. Monk.
Chip.
Chip Monks.
Chocolate chip.
Sandip.
I can't remember his name. I can't remember his last. But
I don't
chip,
remember
I
either.
I played.
Boy, I'm glad that's not a stump the expert question.
Played the ukulele.
Now it is.
Failed. Yeah, maybe now it is. Exactly.
I got to join him. I got to join the elite of playing instruments on stage.
Yeah.
I played got the ukulele.
Yeah, you learned it for that, didn't you?
I did learn it for that.
You had to play the ukulele proposal.
There is an audition CD somewhere in the ether where we sent you. Molly and I played the bass. Molly played the bass. I played the uke. We went and bought a uke, bought a book, and we played it. We played the songs for you, and we sent you something to show that we could play.
Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And Molly and I were like, I think we only learned 2 or 3 chords, you know, to show you that we would play. And then we come... And they're like, great, you guys, we did great. You're like, oh yeah, we'd love to have you. We came up and Paul writes this song and he's like, here you go. And it had
over 20 chords.
Yeah.
You know, I was like, okay, I think I got this. And then we worked it down to like a dozen chords, you know. So it was good. It was a good challenge. It was fun.
Plus,
was
fun. You had to do choreography.
And we then Pam was so glad. Like, she's like, oh, you're doing such a good job. We'll do this and this and this and this.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know,
it was adorable.
It was fun.
Like, godmother, if I had a godmother, when she was like 20 in the height of like 60s coffee house culture, and she learned the guitar and she learned Leaving on a Jet Plane and Amazing Grace, and she went and auditioned at her local coffee house to play, and they were like, yeah, sure, come on. And then they hired her for 2 hours, and she played Leaving on a Jet Plane and Amazing Grace on a loop for two hours. That's all she knew.
No way. There was enough turnover traffic, or it was driving people out, or
full 2 hours.
Like, she got really good at those songs, I'm sure, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
Well, and you know, Chase, we were just talking about trying to figure out what it was that we, what instruments that we played together at Door Shakespeare, because that's when you and I met.
Yes.
Oh.
Yes.
At Door Shakespeare, yes. In 2005.
Right.
Yeah. Yep. Yep.
We lived together in 2005 and 2006, I'm pretty sure.
Something like
at
that.
The ye old Robinson House.
Up in
Allison
Bay.
Bay.
Yeah, up there.
Chase had a label maker, and he labeled the things in the kitchen.
I did. I had a fun label maker, and it was great because two letters broke, and we couldn't use these two letters, so we had to be very creative in how we wrote things.
Like, Chase called coffee Get Going Juice, except for the J didn't work, so he called it Get Going Juice with a G. I really liked
the K and the J broke, and I was like, well, what are you going to do?
That's funny.
Get Going Goose.
Yeah, so I think I tried to show, like, surprise people with labels around the house.
So, Chase, tell everybody what else you do at Northern Sky besides just act on stage, because you do a number of different things.
I do.
Some have to do with merchandise, I believe.
I do have merchandise. Well, one of the first, yeah. Well, I brought some show and tell. If I can
show.
Oh,
yeah. Let's do show and tell. It's not a regular segment on our show.
We found these are
turning into one.
It was great. Molly and I were going through all of our binders and music, and I mean, we have binders and music from.
And binders.
Oh my
gosh. Music and binders.
Just yes. Yeah. And then like multiple. And then we do a show. We get a new binder
and
for that
music.
Show. So we were going through those and like trying to narrow everything down and have one copy of things. And well, after our first summer here, we also stayed on for the fall for Main Traveled Roads, and that was in Ephraim Town Hall.
Yeah.
So I got to perform there. And
did you have a good stage, good house manager?
Oh yes, house.
Show?
Who was that?
I don't know.
It was
me.
It was you.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you were there for this, but I have this show and tell. Well, we have, you know, awesome fans, people like, you know, sending us letters. I've got a couple.
Yeah.
And then people drawing awesome pictures of the actors. And some of these, this is from Maggie Godfrey.
Now, Maggie Godfrey, like Katie Dahl, I would classify as a super fan.
Super fan,
right?
Sure.
Super duper fan.
Right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Oh, yes. We came to a show that one night, and these pictures showed up, and then we put them on the
in the
foyer.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah.
Oh, to show
right,
to show people.
Yeah.
Right.
That's nice.
And these are pictures that she drew. She saw the show once. She went, and this is how she tells the story. Then she went and had breakfast at the White Gull Inn.
Uh-huh.
And she used those placemats on the other side to draw these pictures. If I can get these pictures.
Here, maybe I have a better angle.
There you go. There's a picture. That one is Aggie Dingman, and that was Molly's character. And then this one is me. Of Will Hannon, and she has like the detail down to like the design on like the apron and my those are correct colors.
Well,
yeah.
that Maggie Godfrey is no slouch.
No,
she's a real artist. She's studying it in college.
I was so happy to find those. We found those, and then she's drawn other pictures. She's done more digital work, and she sent like fan pictures of No Bones About It.
Yeah,
she sent some in.
Yeah, they were wonderful.
And then Molly and I have been talking. We're talking for years too about like, you know, it'd be great if like we could do a Northern Sky coloring book.
Yeah.
And then first we were just like, oh my gosh, we should see what Maggie, her interest is, and she was down for it, and we sent her some images for her to like see what her interest was, and she was totally down for it. So we then were able to develop the Northern Sky coloring book.
Yeah, which is really lovely.
And it
so
has
great
so
color
many
the Northern
wonderful
Sky
images that we and. The pages are laid out so that when you open them up, you can share coloring. You can color with a friend or somebody. And experiences. It has the original cast listings on there and who, you know, the writers. and the composers. And
we
then, like,
included
a
coloring book
there.
in our box that we sent out to raise the curtain.
Yeah, yeah.
Which was really nice.
And then
nice.
The cover is original design by her.
It's so really cool.
It's a fun, yeah.
Maggie was an intern with us the summer that came out, I believe. Is that right, Chase? I
yes.
think she was here the summer it came out.
Yeah, we got her to, like, because we knew she was going to be part of us that summer.
Exactly,
we
yeah.
work with her, so.
Yeah.
And
yeah.
could someone order one of those on the Northern Sky website?
Sure,
think?
They
yeah.
certainly can.
Okay, good.
I believe they are completely available for
oh,
anybody
yeah.
who would like a coloring book.
So,
we
yeah,
have time for coloring these cool. days in the pandemic.
So merchandise. I also do, and like, when coming here, I was like, maybe I should bring my construction hat, but I do that with, I was doing the construction updates too. We would
oh,
do
yeah.
videos and
right.
oh.
and
Chase
if you
does a ton of video
and if you see the
us.
Manchesky Minute, I am the other guy.
He is the other guy, and the guy responsible for editing those things.
Yes,
put those together.
Yeah,
yeah,
which are great.
So those were fun.
Chase,
oh, yeah.
I mean, what's Doug without an editor?
Truly,
just unleashed.
Chase actually. And his wife Molly helped create the music video for my song "Hometown Tables," actually, which is celebrating its 10-year anniversary.
Is it really?
This summer.
Isn't
yep.
that something?
Wow, 10 years.
Yeah, isn't that crazy?
Boy, that song takes on some new meaning now too, doesn't it?
Sure does.
I know.
Yeah, mm-hmm.
And Katie, you're back now at the cookery, aren't you?
I'm back at the cookery. Yes. When? Thanks for mentioning. That's Wednesdays at from 3 to 5.
So did you have your first gig this
we
past
did.
Week? How'd it go?
It went really well.
Oh, good.
It felt really safe. Like they they're doing a great job of distancing and. And people were in a good mood, and I felt like it was so awesome to be playing for people that I felt like things that normally would stress me out or annoy me at gigs, I was like, like the road noise, you know, what I mean?
right,
like the road
right.
noise, and I'm like, the road noise, this is the road noise.
On
like,
the new road.
Oh, I'm setting up the PA, it's hot yeah. and I'm sweaty. Oh, I'm setting up the PA, it's amazing. So it was, that made me feel
that's
really
cool.
That's
happy.
Great.
Those are fun.
Yeah. yeah. Yeah, so Chase does. Chase wears a lot of hats.
Yes.
Go ahead, tell us.
I do. We also crochet hats.
Oh,
yes,
yeah,
you do.
Right.
And we did. We also had that as an item for Raise the Curtain this year as well, and we were going to do 30 hats for $30.
Right.
And
you mean $30 a piece?
$30 a piece.
Yeah.
Yes, for a hat.
For a hat.
So you know, we put that out there, and these are, I call them like scrap hats. I call them, you know, they're just multicolored. They're one of a kind.
Yeah.
And so I make them, you know, somebody orders a hat, I'll make you a hat. And so we put them out. They sold out.
Yeah.
Pretty quickly. And I was like, oh, go ahead. Let's do another round. So
yeah.
we did round two.
60.
60. Boom. I sold 60.
Boom.
And then I was like, all right, let's do another round. So we sold 90 hats total.
30 plus 30
that
plus 30.
So
yeah,
amazing.
We did. So I did the first delivery in June. So I got the whole month of July to get the second round. And then please wait. I hope you wait. Please be patient till August.
Chase, how long does it take you to make one of those hats?
An hour.
About an hour?
Yeah, about an hour. Yeah.
I said this at one of our things that I notice sometimes when I'm giving notes as a director, Chase is like furiously working away. And I'm like, yeah, okay.
I've been listening. I was listening.
I know
I
you were.
The notes.
I know you were. I know you were.
Liz Weston says she can't wait to get her hat.
Hey, thank you.
We also
yes.
have a lot of highs. Hi, Deb Weber. Hi, Cindy Steele. Hi, Dorothy Higdon. Hi, Kelly.
Well,
hi, Dee.
A little teaser. Later in the show, the crochet theme's going to come back.
Oh, it is?
Yes.
Oh.
I know.
Right.
I like to surprise Katie Dahl.
I am because
Katie Dahl, Katie Dahl, you do like sort of a really interesting, you know, take back on surprises. I love it. Yeah. So I like to see that happen. To Katie Dahl. Yeah, so that's going to come back. But before we do that, I understand that we might have a little segment of Stump the Expert
we
again.
Sure might.
Oh.
I do set we? Myself up for this because as the aforementioned crochet teaser is going to come back in the form of a trivia quiz. But until then, we need to sustain ourselves with trivia.
That's right.
Because the trivia monsters amongst us can't get enough.
That's right.
All right.
Okay, so Chase, should I go first?
Sure, go ahead.
Yeah.
What
okay.
format is this?
Well, it's true or false.
Oh, true or false.
True or false.
These are true or false questions about Chase and me.
50-50.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. The first one's a softball. We gave it away already. True or false? Katie and Chase were once roommates.
Katie and Chase were once roommates.
Yes.
But not necessarily at Northern Sky.
No, that wasn't in the question.
It wasn't in the question.
In fact,
so
we were never roommates at Northern Sky, but I did take over... My company
you did move in to the abode,
to
yes.
To the Bentley Cottage and the...
You did?
Yeah.
You did
what
for
year?
A fall, yeah.
2008, as I was house managing for Dan Fogelberg.
Oh, yeah.
And They had just finished their summer, and oh, yeah. Chase and Molly are real avid like gardeners and like flower. They grow flowers and other things. And I had this at this point, I'm a little bit better about the kind of thing than I used to be. But at the time, I was like, I had real flower blindness. And Chase and Molly were like walking me around the carefully cultivated property. They're like, we've planted these flowers here and these flowers here and these flowers here. And I was like, you guys. I hate to tell you this, like I will try to remember to water them, but I'm not remembering.
Well, we did, that year we did flowers. Like there's like 8 foot tall sunflowers.
It was amazing.
Like they had these huge. I think you even took pictures in front of those.
Press shots from the.
Yeah,
from
you're
glad
hard
you did.
Of hearing horticulturally.
Exactly.
Is that where you are?
Yes, that's right. Botanical deafness or something. Okay, good. Now your turn.
Okay. Do we have another one? Okay, go ahead.
Okay.
Oh yeah, that wasn't the only one.
True or false? True or false?
Yeah.
Katie and I share the same birthday.
That's false.
Yes. I think.
Okay.
When is your birthday, Katie?
March 19th.
Oh,
wow, that took a long
time.
Like
a month off. I'm June 18th.
Oh yeah.
So we're close.
Yeah.
June 18th.
We're Geminis.
No.
Are you March? Oh no, you're not May. I'm the wrong month.
Yeah.
Cut that.
I was gonna let it go.
Oh. So
what are you? Pisces?
Me, I'm a Pisces.
Oh, there you go. Okay.
On the cusp. Between that and Aries?
I'm a Gemini.
Yeah.
All right.
I don't know anything about astrology, by the way.
Oh, me neither. But my son is March 23rd, and he's an Aries, and I'm 19th, and I'm a Pisces.
Oh.
I'll give you 25 points for that.
Okay.
Excellent. Thank you very much.
Okay.
I appreciate that, Chase.
True or false? Katie and Chase both won their fifth grade spelling bees.
I think that's going to be true.
No, I did not.
You did not. You did not win it, Chase. You came in second.
No, I was a math guy.
You were a math guy. Welcome to the show.
Oh, yeah, thank you.
Yeah.
Actually, I think the only spelling bee I was in was like third grade.
Oh.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
I take the note that I'm hard to hear. Here I am.
Oh.
All right.
Closer. Okay.
Next.
Now for our last one.
Oh yes.
Should we skip the last one because we gave it away?
No, ask me anyway because I don't have a terrible memory. Okay,
let's do a bonus.
Okay.
So Katie and I
produced
a music video of her hit song, County Line.
I would say that that's true because I just heard it about 5 minutes ago.
You would be wrong.
It's a little technicality. It wasn't County Line.
Oh, you didn't produce it.
No, it wasn't County Line. It was Hometown Tables.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
That's bad. That
okay,
was bad
the
of
bonus
me.
Bonus round.
That was a tricky one.
No, it wasn't tricky. I wasn't paying attention.
Yeah, bonus round. Great. Go ahead. Yeah.
True or false?
Yes.
Katie and Chase have the same color glasses.
Oh, see if he's paying attention.
Through the plexiglass, I would say, in having my memory jogged, that you do not.
Oh, let's see.
Oh, they're very similar.
Pretty similar.
They're very green.
You can see
Excellent.
Yes.
I did really poorly on that.
So minus 50 points.
Stump the expert. I'm not sure that it should have. I don't think that it was appropriately named because
I do not
consider myself an expert on Katie and Chase relationship.
Surprise.
But now I'm
now
closer.
Yeah.
I'm closer now to having that name. Okay. That was fun, you guys. Thanks for putting together that.
True. True. I'm going to say true to that.
I'm going to do a little song. Is that good?
Yeah. Are you going to tell us anything about it?
Yeah, I think I will. This is, you know, sometimes we talk at Northern Sky. Recently, we've been talking about it even more, about what would it be like for us to have gender mix-up, in a way, on songs. So have men sing songs that are traditionally sung by women and vice versa. We tried that little experiment, as we mentioned, with Lumberjacks. We did a whole reading where we swapped gender, and Katie played Muskrat, and I played Rosemary Rogers, and it was fun. It breaks down in some weird ways with the gender switch for that show because there's already so much gender confusion, mm-hmm. but it's still sort of interesting.
Yeah.
At any rate, I was just looking through Fishing for the Moon, which is a show that Chase appeared in back in 2008.
Yep. And would be appearing in now in
a non-pandemic
world.
No, he wasn't going to be in it this
time. No, I wasn't.
Oh, you
because
weren't.
He was,
no,
it
was
because it conflicted with dad's season tickets. I know, right? Yeah.
It's a good
show. I actually had a lovely email from Chase saying, are you really going to do Fishing for the Moon without me? And I'm like, oh. I know, because it's such a lovely show. At any rate, there's a song in there called Where Does Love Go? And it's sung by Shirlene, who's the wife of Shirlene and Tuck. And Tuck is now a retired Civil War Army guy, like a general or a corporal or a captain or one of those ranks. And he's gone a little batty, you know? And Charlene's really worried about him. But the truth is, this day and age, and there's no mention of anything like Alzheimer's in that show. It's not that. It's musical theater, right? But this kind of song, I've just been thinking about how hard all this isolation is especially for older people who are living alone. And I can't even imagine what it'd be like right now if you were taking care of somebody with Alzheimer's and you couldn't have your family in to help you out, and you suddenly were thrust into this role of having to be a caretaker. At any rate, I just think Where Does Love Go kind of fits in that category of, you know, what is it these days? Who are we? And I have to put on my transpose button, otherwise it would be too low, because it's normally sung by an alto. I am not an alto. Katie Dahl is an alto.
I am an alto.
Where does love go when it runs away? Does someone know? The man I married, where has he gone? Where is the star I wished upon? The hope I carried, where can it be? Where is the man who once loved me? Where does love go when it runs away? Does someone know how to make love stay? You can't hold water with your fingers. There's nothing left to hold. Love's memory still lingers when your hands are old. Where has he gone? Where is the star I wished upon? Where does love go when it runs away? Does someone know?
So lovely. I love that song.
It is impossible to hear myself. I can't hear the piano and I can't hear the vocal. It's so weird out here.
I have news, everyone. A mouse just ran into our building.
Oh, goody, goody.
I just saw it. We have a door.
We have the door jammed open because we had to put a cable through the lobby.
Oh, ay, ay,
ay.
Where's the bakery?
Right?
Oh, yeah, the bakery.
It's all right.
Are we at the Bake Off now?
We maybe better be.
I think we should be. I think we are, and we should be.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay. You guys entertain one another. I'm going to go get stuff.
And
we're going to bring it out. And like last week, I think we're going to try and do it blind, right?
Yeah.
Ish.
So Chase is gonna,
what
yep.
do I do? I just sit
you
here?
You just sit here. You just enjoy yourself.
Yeah, and chat with Katie, and I'll be right back.
Oh, my goodness. Okay.
I was going to tell you that. Yes. So the first, well, we should say, I don't know if we said that song is by Fred Alley and James Kaplan from Fishing for the Moon. But I was going to say that the first time I remember hearing that, so I think the first time it was performed was by an actor named Megan Kavanaugh, who was at AFT, then AFT, in 1997.
Okay.
And 98, 97, one of you can tell me. She played Marla Hooch in A League of Their Own.
Oh, wow.
Yes, okay. Which was my favorite. I mean, I had a lot of favorite movies, but that was one of them. I probably saw that movie 100 times as a kid.
And she performed up here
at IFT.
Cool.
The year before she was in the Fishing for the Moon, she was just visiting and I just saw her. I was like, I'm sure I was like stalking Karen Mall. You know, I'm sure I was like had my eyes out for all the other celebrities, but I saw Megan Kavanaugh and I was like, but wait, all my celebrity worlds are, you know, colliding all at one time. So it was very exciting.
I had fun doing that show. Rufus was my character, and he didn't bathe, and that was the whole thing about him. He finally used soap to clean himself.
Are you thinking about Dirty Bob?
No, well, that's a thing. The first time I did that show, and then we did Lumberjacks in Love, which has a soap thing as well.
Oh.
It's not big. It's not prominent as big as Dirty Bob. It's just that he finally, Rufus finally cleans himself up to impress the teacher.
Oh, okay.
Yeah, it's very. It's not super big like Dirty
Bob.
It
have to do with like the Parisian soap that Lucy is like wants.
I think so.
Is, like, trying
I remember
to
like picking
Gary's
up the soap.
Brain
yeah.
with. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
So, yes.
Yes.
But
Rufus,
there's this. There's
Rufus
this. I don't know. But there's like a soap thing going on with those two shows. I was like,
yeah,
oh, okay.
Yeah, and well, it's a theme. It's a. It's a recurring motif in Fred Alley's work. I think that's what we can learn. We want to say hi to Becca and Liz and Dwayne and Janet.
Hey.
Your mother-in-law.
Yep, they're down, down
Cindy,
in Florida.
Yes, you, and Angeline.
I did see Angeline, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yay.
Cool.
Yes, hooray. And how are you enjoying your Door County summer so far, Chase?
It's going really well.
Yeah.
It's really, yeah. I get to spend some time with my parents. My parents are from Door County.
Right.
So I do have some roots up here. Funny enough, but like we never experienced Northern Sky when we were growing up, because we would stay more in Sturgeon Bay.
Yeah, they're like Southern Door kind of people.
Yeah,
Sebastopol
They went to Sebastopol. My parents are pioneers.
Uh-huh.
Yep. And graduated, I think, in 68, and then ended up going down to the Milwaukee area, and that's kind of where I grew up. But my mom was very adamant about spending time with grandparents, so came up here. Like holidays, summers. So, but we would kind of stay away from this upper area because, you know, it gets busy. My parents were just like, we can stay with grandparents.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, that's good.
Yeah. So, I've been coming to Door County all my life.
Yeah.
All my life. Yeah.
Baked items appears to be time sensitive.
What?
Oh, wow.
Be careful.
Thank you. Oh, yeah. My goodness.
I have to eat all this, right?
This is crazy.
Yes,
okay.
You must.
I have to eat all this?
Here, okay. So we don't know who made what. We've got David Alley, our sound guy, is in on the game here. So we've got an item from Dave, an item from Jeff, and an item from Katie.
That's right. That's the usual bake-off trio.
What we have here is like some sort of muffin.
Some kind of a muffin.
We've got some sort of like a
some kind of a crumble
cake. Yep. And we've got some sort of other cake with ice cream on it.
Right.
Which is, so, okay, I'm going to eat the ice cream one first on account of.
On account of it's ice creamy and it's hot out here.
I'm going to,
I would do that if
this
I were
looks
you.
Good.
Oh, my gosh. This is, I'm going to just tell you about this ice cream business. The frosting seems so delicious that you had to, it's like very thick and delicious seeming. Mm.
Is it, that looks interesting.
Mm. Mm. Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
Wow. So now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, I don't know. We'll have to ask the maker, whoever this maker is. Later.
This yeah okay.
About it, but I would like to say that there's like it's like a turtle cake. Like there's caramel.
Yes. Yeah, it does seem like a turtle on top.
Mm-hmm.
Turtle on top cake.
Turtle on top.
Hmm.
Mm, I swallowed my turtle.
My turtle.
So you better not eat that whole one, Chase, before you taste the other ones.
Oh, I can't do that. All right. Sorry.
this show will go until 8 o'clock tonight. Those are very big pieces of cake that.
Very astonishing.
Up.
I'm gonna do this muffin.
Oh my gosh, so good.
So if there was icing on top of this, it'd be technically a cupcake, right?
Is well, that yeah. They're like, what is the line between muffin and cupcake?
Yeah, it's a very fine line.
It's a fine line.
It definitely is.
Mm-hmm.
I love a good muffin and I love a good cupcake.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Mm. Mm.
Hmm.
Very good.
Really good, huh?
Very good muffin. What's in there? Cherries?
I don't know what
rhubarb?
Could be in there.
I don't know.
Whoever made that one.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Mm. It's a
great consistency.
You know, we've had a lot of people requesting that we start that we start posting some of these recipes, which we probably should do. And people are apparently wanting to be encouraged to bake along with us or, you know, eat with us because they're getting jealous.
These are kind of similar, these two. There's like a, I'm saying a cherry and there's rhubarb. And this looks like little rhubarb in there, too.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Right?
That was really good.
Mm. Wow.
Wow, everyone. Oh, my gosh.
Wow.
So, Chase Stoeger,
I came on a good week.
Are you ready to use another verb to declare a winner?
Oh, my.
What verb should he use?
Oh,
win.
Okay. Wow.
Okay.
I'm trying to think of the other verbs.
Can I? Okay. All right. This is good variety. I like this. This is wonderful.
Yeah, I know, right?
I would all eat this again. I'm going to finish these today, too. I'm impressed. These are wonderful. Oh, gosh. I love them all. But I'm going to say my favorite's going to be this coffee cake.
Excellent.
David
Alley.
Hey,
Dave.
You're the winner.
Dave's
first
win.
Awesome.
That's fantastic.
That's wonderful. It's very good. I was talking to you about this cherry dessert I found on a cherry pitter. You get the cherry pitter on the top of the jar, and it came with a recipe. This is kind of like it.
Yeah.
It's very good. It's got a nice crunchy sugar top.
Mm-hmm. Now, I would like to reveal that Jeff Herbst made this amazing chocolate cake and ice cream, which I am very excited about.
Did you make
about.
The ice cream?
Did you make the ice cream?
I didn't make the ice cream, no.
But is it... Okay, so tell me about this. Is it like a turtle...
It is kind of a turtle... Cake? It's like a variation on a turtle cake.
That's good.
The cake itself has some nice culprits in it. It's got buttermilk to add a little tang.
Mm.
And it also has coffee. And then, yes, you're right. It has a pecan caramel middle layer beneath the chocolate ganache.
It's so good.
Right?
And is it caramel ice cream that you put with it?
I wanted to get vanilla, but the store was out, so I got turtle ice cream.
Very
it's decadent on
there
decadent. I thought, why not?
Very good. All this is good.
Why not, right?
Oh, but my gosh, I love it.
I like
it.
Your the little
chocolate
top.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Well, that cake goes. The honor goes to my mother for that cake. Although she had some, again, we're back to your mom doesn't like the word picky for eating. What does she call selective?
But discerning.
Discerning. Mm-hmm. Well, my sister's sister, whose name rhymes with belly, is also said that she is discerning. But I don't think she likes nuts.
Oh.
So my mom couldn't put the pecans. I'm like, then it's not a turtle cake. It can't be a turtle cake without pecans.
No.
That's
what makes the shell. That's what makes the turtle shell.
Oh.
Don't you think?
Makes the
The candy? Or what are you talking about?
Pecan? I don't know. Like, turtle means... Like, why would turtle mean that if the hard thing didn't mean the shell?
How did chocolate caramel and pecans become turtles?
Jeff disagrees.
I'm totally there, Katie doll. Whatever you just said, yes to turtle and pecan shells.
And Katie, the muffin was delicious too.
Everything was good.
Yes.
Good.
Delicious.
Mm.
Too good for words.
Oh, homemade
okay, kids.
Goodness.
We're coming back
okay,
to
kids.
Our.
Ooh. Is it
nap time? I always lose track of time.
Oh, it's that Lisa says she doesn't like coffee.
Who? Lisa who?
Kelly, I assume. Lisa, your sister, right? Is Lisa Madsen your sister?
Yeah, but the coffee's in the cake. Nobody knows there's coffee in it. It just boosts the chocolate flavor. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Although,
although
if you have stout.
Well, look at Lisa.
If you have coffee stout, you can taste the coffee. Don't you think?
Mm. Oh, you mean,
like a beer?
Are you saying in a beer?
Yes.
Yeah, oh, for sure. Yeah,
right?
You can taste
if
the
you
coffee.
Have, you know, if you have coconut coffee stout, you taste the coconut and the coffee.
Yes. And the stout.
Oh, yes.
And the stout. Yes, that goes without saying, but Katie Dahl said it.
Kelly says, I love pecans.
Why? Who doesn't like them then? Why were they? Mother, is my mother watching this show? Mother, get in the chat room and tell people why you deprived us of pecans and the turtle cake. Right now. It's absolute. Okay.
I don't know if we're going to come back around.
Can I just remind them?
Yeah.
That if you're feeling you're sitting there and you're thinking, oh, I'm a little bit full. I have a little bit too much something. And you're thinking, you know, it could be a problem in your bank account. There could be a few extra bucks that maybe could leap, I tell you, into the virtual bucket.
There you go.
And if you did, you know, the way the money is, it's all virtual right now, so you might not be able to quite put your finger on what it is that wants to come out and into the bucket, but I'm pretty sure that it is just a few bucks, and that'll help us keep our development work afloat. And it is paypal.me/abuck in the bucket. Now, interestingly, all these people are answering us about your pecan thing, but
I bet they are.
Yeah.
Yeah, I saw one.
Yeah, people.
Janet
probably...
was
okay.
Describing.
First of all, Chase's mother-in-law Janet says, "Pecans are feet, caramel the body, chocolate the shell, a turtle." Oh, okay, great.
Oh.
Diane says everything sounds delicious. That's right. Lisa says she's watching with Kelly,
agree.
So Kelly will answer. Oh, and so Kelly's answer is they were too, or your mom's answer is they were too expensive.
Oh well, you're off the hook, Mom.
You're totally off the hook. You baked us a chocolate caramel cake on a budget.
Yeah, right.
Who's complaining?
What's to complain about? Right.
Okay, so we're coming back now, back around to the expertise of
trivia
of realmencrochet.com. Is you still have that, or is that
a
real thing?
I'm still using Real Men Crochet. Yep.
Real Men Crochet.
I have that on like Instagram, Facebook. Yeah.
Now it might interest you to know that there is a there's some kind of a crochet guild of America.
Okay.
So I got a lot of my information from that. I don't know if it's a reputable source or not, but according to the history of crochet.
Okay. Yes.
Men did start out as the initial crocheters.
Say, like sailors, probably.
Well, of course,
that's correct.
Crotchety old men.
Crotchety old man. Oh, Katie Doll.
Well, they need
to know a
lot of knots, and they fix nets, and they
got
to fix clothing.
Right. It was a form of crochet. Mm-hmm. Yeah. I always thought it would be more like macrame, but I guess they're all sort of related, aren't they?
In the sense, yeah. You're pretty much knotting that together in one long line.
Well, we'll see what you know about the history of crochet down there. Now, this is really, you guys can confer like we did last week.
Okay.
Yeah. So, this is again in the form of a multiple choice.
Uh-huh.
Okay. You know, you'll have three different answers to choose from. All right. Crochet began turning up in Europe in the early 1800s and was given a tremendous boost by a woman who was best known for her ability to take old style needle and bobbin lace designs and turn them into crochet patterns that could easily be duplicated. And she published a bunch of pattern books so that millions of women, remember this is in the 1800s, could begin to copy her designs. What was her name? A, Madame Thénardier. B, Mademoiselle Riego de la Branchardière. Or C, Madame Thérèse Defarge.
I mean, it's not A.
Why is that?
Unless she has been, unless she's been sort of immortalized in Les Mis without her crochet.
Very good, Katie.
I was leaning towards C.
You already won a bonus point.
Very nice. I would just say C.
Okay, great. C.
C.
No, that was another decoy.
Oh.
That was another decoy. It was in fact, Mademoiselle Riego de la Branchardière. C.
I like this.
Madame Thérèse Defarge.
Yeah.
She is also a literary character. She shows up in Tale of Two Cities. She's the one who knits.
Both
of these are knitting references, by the way, the decoys, because the bonus point, yes, Madame Thénardier reference from Les Mis, ragged and barelegged, this is from the book, ragged and barelegged in her wooden shoes, Cosette, under the thumb of Madame Thénardier, is knitting. I couldn't find any crocheting, but knitting. That's why it was a decoy.
Yes.
Woolen socks for Eponine and Alzelma, the Thénardier daughters.
Mm.
Oh, in the book there are two Thénardier daughters.
I think there are three.
Oh, in the musical there's just one.
Just Eponine.
Yeah.
Mm. I know.
Wow.
And then another bonus point for the Defarge reference. No, you already missed that one. You didn't get it.
Nope.
Madame Defarge is the bitter knitter.
Ooh, I like
that.
That's
bad,
a good
name. And wine shop owner in a Tale of Two. Have you read Tale of Two Cities?
No.
Oh, you should. Yeah, Matt, you would have known it if you
had an afternoon.
It's a novel about the French Revolution,
times.
Right?
Yes.
Who wrote it?
The Tale of Two Cities?
Yeah.
Dickens.
Yeah. Madame Defarge likes to knit the names of the aristocrats she plans to send to the guillotine into her work.
Oh, my.
Oh, how very,
nefariously,
how very
kind of villainous.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. All right.
So zero points. 0 points.
We got one bonus point.
You got one
bonus point.
Yeah,
okay.
Bonus
point.
All right. As the 1800s
Ding.
Progressed,
Ding.
Techniques for proper crocheting continued to develop. Which of the following was an accurate account of recommended technique in the 1800s? This is really for you because I don't know any of these.
Okay.
And some may or may not be made up.
That's true.
A, in 1833, a Dutch magazine said that both the yarn and hook were to be held in the right hand and the yarn passed over the hook from the right forefinger.
Okay.
Chase is processing this, and he's sort of saying that could be possible.
I'm pretending to process.
B, are you a crocheter?
Me? I've done it, but I'm not very...
Oh,
yeah.
But that one didn't make any sense to you?
You
glazed over.
It made a ton of sense to me. I understand everything.
Okay. B, in a crochet book from the 1840s, it was suggested that, quote, the hook is held in the right hand and the yarn in the left,
as right-handers do today. Look at Chase over there. He's like, Chase is
right with her with it. This
and
is,
C,
so
in a German publication dated 1847, it stated that one should always, quote, keep the same tension, either crochet loosely or crochet tightly. Otherwise, an attractively even texture will not be achieved. Moreover, if not working in the round, you have to break off your yarn at the end of each row, since this gives a finer finish to the crocheted article.
Wow.
What?
Wait, so what's the question?
The question is, which of these techniques
is
was real? A real technique?
Oh, wow, okay. Was or is still?
I don't know. Oh, you tell me,
is
crochet
it
man.
This is a trick question. All three of them are?
Well, all three of them are. Do any?
So, okay, yeah. I would say the last two are techniques. And the first one you described, I don't see how you could do that by crocheting with the material in one hand and the hook in one hand. Because the second one, you're talking about how the materials, you have the hook and then the material, which is how I do it.
Yeah.
And then when you're talking about tension in the third one, you need to have a constant tension or you'll have, which I did my first blanket wrong that way. It was like, anyway. Yeah. And so I'm going to say A. Because that one just sounds
Yeah, no, they're
hard.
Actually all techniques. Oh. And I think I know, Chase, you're really good, though.
Oh, thanks.
I think the thing that happened was in that A version where you're talking about everything being in the same hand, people are like, don't do
that
anymore.
Works now.
That was the first technique that they got rid of, apparently.
I could
But it was a real
developed
technique, from that. And it was a Dutch magazine called Penelope, of all things.
Oh.
Right? Oh. Okay. Okay, now one last question. Moving through Victorian times, crochet patterns became available for flower pot holders, bird cage covers, baskets for visiting cards, lamp mats and shades, waste paper baskets, tablecloths, tobacco pouches, purses, men's caps and waistcoats, and anti-macassars. Anti-macassars.
Anti-macassars.
What is an anti-macassar?
Oh, no.
Anti-macassar. Well,
oh, do you
want to
take a guess without
Dorothy's
A, B, and C?
Aunt. She's Dorothy lives with
Anti-macassar.
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 Will you make that turtle cake?
A decorative corset popularly worn by ladies of the evening while awaiting customers in bordellos.
Oh, my.
B, an original skull and crossbones flag used by pirates who had developed crochet skills as a way of passing the time on the high seas before plundering and looting. Or C, a cover to protect chair backs from the hair oil worn by men in the mid-1800s.
Ew.
Oh, our anti-macassars.
Ew.
Shiver me timbers.
Anti-macassar.
How you say
anti-macassar.
Macassar?
I don't know. It's one of those.
Well, anti seems to be like to stop
B.
Being
anti-macassar.
Something.
Oh, yeah. Oh, to stop. Oh,
to stop something.
Or before something like an antechamber, an antebellum.
Yeah. And I mean,
right.
I love C. I love the idea of C because like.
Chase, ding, 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 ding.
Is it?
Yes. Yes. That was really good of you to pick up on the anti. So bonus point. What is macassar?
Is it, you were saying oil, is macassar like a cream? Or
it
a
is.
Hair
it's
thing?
An oil. But oil. What is macassar? What is the derivative?
Casser.
It's a proper noun.
Castor oil?
No, I'm going to give you another clue. It's geography.
Oh, it's from Ireland.
No.
Macassar.
No. No, not Mick MC. It's
McCaffrey. it's a tough one.
Okay. It's located on the southwest coast of the island of Sulawesi, facing the Macassar Strait.
Is that South Africa?
With all of those clues, bonus points if you can name the country where Macassar is located.
South Africa?
No.
Is it one of those island countries?
Oh. Yes. Not in Africa, though.
Oh.
America. Is it South America?
An island
Central
country.
America?
Yes. Good luck,
Barbados.
Katie Dahl. No, not
Bermuda.
Wrong part of the world.
Oh. But it's not in Africa either.
No.
It's in South America?
No.
Japan?
It's in Fiji? Is it East? Fiji?
It's over there.
Is it Japan?
Oh.
It's not.
Is it Bali?
No. Well, Bali is not a country, but Bali is part of this country, too.
Oh no. Indonesia.
That's correct.
Yes.
Hey. It is Indonesia.
You get half a point.
Right. And Katie Dahl, for you alone, can you name the demonym of people from Macassar?
Indonesians?
No. Strictly related to only people from Macassar.
Oh, Macassarians.
Wrong. Macassaries.
Oh, Macassaries is how the real.
Is that how you would say it? Did I throw you off? Chase Stoeger, you are a real crochet person.
Am I? Yeah. Good.
Oh, that's what we can determine
Proven
from here.
It.
Oh, by the way, I did bring some
great. I love
myself.
That history.
Katie, you might have to show these. I figured this could be a good thing for real men to crochet.
I have seen some of these outfits. I found I'm a thrifter. You know that.
Yeah.
And finding some of the, I'll dig and I'll find books, like craft books from the 80s and 70s.
Yeah.
Amazing.
And
amazing
this one,
creation.
I figured a new hat for you to do.
Oh, wow. Is that like a Medusa?
It's a Medusa hat.
Wow.
Isn't that fantastic?
The things people do create, I'm impressed. Like
this one's going to be the winter
animals.
Apparel for the Jeff and Katie show, since we'll still have to be outside.
Oh yes, I think you just start somewhere and you can keep adding.
And these two, I think, are really interesting. This guy crochets with found plastic bags.
Okay. Oh sure, yeah, I've
and
a lot
that's
of people
a
love,
a,
see
a
that.
Garden installation, which is you know, he's obviously playing the irony, since they're plants.
There's a wonderful
of
TED Talk
about discarded plastic bags. And then finally, if you ever want to get into crocheting wire, you can make me one of these because I think it's gorgeous.
Okay.
That's crocheted sculpture.
That's...
How did you get a picture of my
house? Aren't
very
they cool?
Modern.
Yeah, it's very cool.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a lot of things out there. I mean, it's expanded to what it has been, and it's really cool. You can do a lot of stuff.
So I enjoyed learning all about crochet.
I did too.
I learned more
and
today, too.
I'm glad
too.
That you're a crocheter and gave me that opportunity.
Well, thanks
so
for
I think... The sun is starting to set. It's kind of amazing. We're a little worried about some weather
distance.
That might be flying in from...
It sort of smells like rain.
The Northwest. I think we're going to close out our Jeff and Katie show with one final song.
Don't forget that buck in the bucket.
Oh, yes.
That is very... We'd say that in the park, that if... Each person, well, maybe you shouldn't explain what we say.
Well, the buck in the bucket in the park works beautifully because it really works out mathematically, which is my favorite kind of thing.
He loves it. He loves
that
math.
If everybody who comes to see us during the season just drops seriously one buck in the bucket, it adds up at the end of the year to give us enough to do our new works development for that year. And year after year that we've been doing the buck in the bucket, we almost always get very near that amount of money. The number of people come to see us equals $1. Per person, and the same thing happens in a virtual world as well. We still need the same amount of money to do our new works development. So,
and if you go online, you can go to the webpage. You can you can buy merchandise.
Oh, yeah, you can
too.
Help by buying merchandise.
You can buy something that you may not really need, but feel good about it.
There you go.
That's right.
That's my
coloring
favorite.
Book.
That
a hat.
My favorite.
Are you still selling hats?
Yeah.
Oh, good.
But that buck in the bucket, Katie Doll CD, you could buy a Katie Doll CD.
You can buy all those things.
But that buck in the bucket is paypal.me/abuckinthebucket.
And what's this final song you guys going to do?
Well, so when Chase and Molly got married in 2013? They were going to have a party afterward where we could sing songs.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But I had a horrible case of laryngitis. I was very unable to sing. So I did not sing this song. But what Rich and I learned this song, my husband Rich, and I learned the song to sing to Chase and Molly. And then Chase and Molly, you guys really liked it.
We did.
And Rich and I sang it at a little baptism ceremony, a little celebration ceremony for your daughter Sylvia, too.
And we sang that for probably 2 years straight every night to Sylvia.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's so great.
I'm paying attention because all this information is going to end up on
it's
a true
gonna
and false.
It's going to be on a quiz.
Yeah, be ready for that.
Just know it.
And so this song is in A Mighty Wind. This is from A Mighty Wind, the Christopher Guest movie.
Okay.
Here we go.
Yep.
When I'm standing next to you, there's a song to sing. I know everything's feeling right. When I'm standing next to you, steeple bells ring. Only good things do I see when you're next to me. When I hold your hand in mine, different world wakes, a new morning breaks with the sun. When I hold your hand in mine, children's dreams take flight through a starlit night. That's what I see when you're next to me.
This love for you I'm feeling has a power that is healing. It can mend the darkest hour with glorious light. When I taste your lips so sweet, I see beggars dine and the sands of time up and stop. When I taste your lips so sweet, black and white bend, every dove lands at your feet when you're next to me. This love for you I'm feeling has a power that is healing. It can bend the darkest hour with glorious light. When I'm lying next to you, I feel moonbeams burn. I see rainbows turn into gold. When I'm lying next to you, I hear angels play. I see sweeter days. I see rivers wind through the end of time. I see hatred fall from the highest hill. I see God's good grace shining in your eyes. That's what I see when you're next to me.
Thank you, everybody. Wow, the light just changed dramatically, didn't it? Look at us.
Ooh. Yes.
We're aglow. We're hearing thunder behind us, so we're going to wrap.
Yep. Yeah.
And we're going to say goodbye to all of you good people. And thanks so much for watching the Jeff and Katie Show. And a huge thank you to Chase Stoeger, Double Verb Boy.
And congrats to our winner of the Bake Off, David
Alley.
Yay,
Dave Alley.
Sound guy. Woo!
Excellent.
All right.
Bye, everybody.
Thanks,
bye.
Bye.
Bye,
Instagram.
Instagram. They're always an app.